Good morning, everyone. You're all very welcome. Could we start our service by singing, "There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains." Could we stand as we sing?
Filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners unclean beneath the blood, whose all their guilt is stained. body is, our hope, our only hope in this old world. Praise his name. Let's bow our heads in prayer. We're going to come before the Lord, and we're going to remember those that are sick today again and pray for them, that God will minister to them. Darren McElveen and Wesley, continue to pray for them, and Sister June Billingham needs the Lord, and we pray for Christina and her brother-in-law, Raymond Wright and David Loudon, Sammy Orr and Edna Scott, Peters McGarry and her daughter, Patsy Doherty, and Alec Robinson and Dave Borland, and Sam Bloomfield. We pray for Elizabeth McAreevy and Peter Moy and Joanne Peden. Pray for Philip Archibald too and his family, that God will be with them. We continue to pray for Ray Laverty and Johnny McCurdy, Gwenny Stewart, and we pray for Robert Gilmore. We pray for Paula, that's Rhonda's sister. She's back into hospital again. She's got COVID and sepsis, and we just pray very much for Paula. She's very ill and needs the Lord at this time, and we call upon God for her especially. We pray for Hazel too, and we pray for Jean Scott. Martin and Liz Moore needs the Lord. Alison McClellan too needs God. And we do pray for Bobby Todd and Bobby Archibald and Joan Hunter and Ellen Morris. Continue to pray for Robert Hunter. And we pray very much for Elizabeth Henry. She's still up in the Royal, and she's gone through surgery in her leg. And we just pray very much for Elizabeth. She's having a really, really bad time. So we call upon God for her. We pray for Jack and the team, Karis, and going to Romania this morning. And we do pray that God will be with all those young people, and the Lord will take care of them while they're away and for 10 days. We pray for Moira too, that the Lord will bless Moira. And we pray for Gillian's mother. She needs the Lord very much, and we call upon God for her. Victor Creelman too needs the Lord, and we just pray for Victor that God will bless him. William Scott also, who needs the Lord. We pray for Eleanor Coulter too, that the Lord will bless her. Don Logan too needs God, and we pray for Don. Martin McGarry also needs the Lord too. And we pray for Tommy McCracken and Stuart Boyd and Ruth McAleese. Vona Brister too needs the Lord. We pray for John Finlay too, that the Lord will bless. We pray for Lila this morning too. She's suffering with this pain in her back, and we do pray for healing for Lila in the name of Jesus. Yes, we pray for Pastor Dempster, and of course we pray for the Sundays or the creche as they go to their classes this morning. We pray for Ukraine and continue to pray that God will indeed just undertake, and for there's indeed many other countries where there's war after war, and we just continue to pray for our world today. Pray for those that are bereaved, that God will indeed comfort them and be with them at this time. We pray for the ministry of God's word, that God will bless his word to our hearts, our lives, this day, in Jesus' name. Here are a lot of needs, and we just pray that God will undertake for them all. We're going to pray. Our gracious God and eternal Father, in heaven we bow before thee again this Lord's Day morning. And Father, we thank and praise God this morning that we're found in the house of the Lord. And Father, thank God for that hunger and desire that we have to be in the house of the Lord. We wouldn't want to be anywhere else, Lord, this morning than to be in your presence and to be among God's people in the house of the Lord. And Father, we're very privileged to be able to come to a place like this, to a beautiful building that we have, Lord, and be able to come and to worship God and to uplift your wonderful name together. And Father, what a wonderful privilege it is. And oh, Father, we thank you and we praise thee, Lord, that we have a Savior who loves us with an everlasting love. We thank you, Father, for salvation without money and without price. We thank God that each one of us, Lord, can look back to a time when we passed from death unto life. Heavenly Father, we just pray for those that are sick this morning, Lord, those that are in hospital. God, you know their very need, and we do pray that, Lord, that you will minister to them this day, and that they will feel the touch of the Master's hand upon their body, even those in the meeting this morning. Father, will feel a touch of the Master's hand upon their body today. Oh, God, we pray, because, Lord, we believe and know that you're the great deliverer. You can heal and deliver, Lord, and set gloriously free, and we're looking to you and depending upon you every step of the way. Bless your word to our hearts today, Lord, do. And we pray, Father, we're depending on you help us to deliver this message, Lord, and to bring it into hearts and lives for the glory of God. Now, Heavenly Father, we just come around your lovely table this morning, and what another great privilege it is to be able to partake of these emblems, Lord. Thank you for Calvary. Thank you for your suffering. Thank you for all that you went through on our behalf, Lord. Father, we can say he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was laid on him. And with his stripes, we are healed. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, we do invite you to join with us this morning around the lovely table of remembrance. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show forth the Lord's death until he come." Thank you, Jesus.
Sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior, bearing shame. Scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, 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 what a Savior.
Delighted to see you all this morning. Give you a very warm welcome in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus. Some announcements to make. First of all, the newsletter. If you haven't had your copy of the monthly newsletter, then it's available in the foyer there to pick up. Also, there's a notice here from Trevor. Church family barbecue and fun night. It's on Saturday, the 30th of July, at between 5 o'clock and 8 o'clock. For all church members, families, and friends, please let us know if you plan to attend so that we know how many to cater for. So do put that in your diary or in your head. Saturday, the 30th of July, 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock. It's going to be a good night, so, well, good night. It's fun. Not sure about the weather yet, but we'll see about that. Trust in God that the weather by that time will have taken up. If you'd like a CD of any of our services, you can have that by putting your name down on the sheet at the back, and we'll get you a CD. 50p box, the little pink box is there. If you'd like to contribute to that, please do so. This evening at 6:30 is our evangelistic service. I will be the speaker. I'm going to speak on prayer, the importance of prayer. I'd like to say that there's no prayer meeting this Wednesday night. It's the 13th of July, in case you didn't maybe know. We'll all be in Scarva or somewhere. So there'll be no prayer meeting this Wednesday night. I think those are all the announcements. We're going to have the praise team now to come and sing for us.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to be back here on this Sunday morning. It's a very exciting Sunday for us because we're doing something a bit different. Today we're launching what we're calling our Beloved Favourites initiative. So part of the goal of our group and part of our vision is that we create a worship environment using the young people's talents to create that environment where people will feel, see and connect with God. And part of that is getting your input into it as the people who are connecting in worship to it. So what we're asking you to do is to tell us your beloved favourite, which is your favourite hymn, your favourite chorus, or your favourite worship song. It's very easy for us as young people to choose pieces that we like. There's a great intergenerational community here in Mount Calvary, so tell us that. People have walked different paths, walked different lives, and had very different experiences with God. And so obviously you've picked up songs and hymns that maybe have sentimental value to you or have a special connection to you, and that's what we would love you to tell us. So at the back there's a sheet, it's blue writing for you to see it, and it says Beloved Favourites. Put your name, your favourite, and whoever was the author or the composer or whatever, and then also tell us why it's your favourite. You can put as much information as you want in it. That would be great because it means that we can connect a lot better to the piece when we're playing it. It's at the back. I would say if you could get them back to us by the 30th of July, if you could return them to Esther. Esther has very kindly volunteered to collate them for us. She will be keeping an eye on them, so she'll be topping them up and chasing you for them, so she will chase you down for them. And we thank Esther for that. So please do return those to us by the end of July, hopefully, and then we'll use the rest of the summer to get those pieces in and working on them, and hopefully you'll see them, maybe your beloved favourite being played in the end of October or around that time. Okay, so that's your homework for the next few weeks. The task for today is this piece, which is Behold Our God. We did this one a few weeks ago, but I think it may have fallen off the bandwagon, so we're going to do standard procedure again. We'll play through it once, and then second time we'll stand to sing. Okay?
Behold our God, seated on his throne, come.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you. We're going to turn to the Word of God now. Will you turn with me, please, to 1 Samuel chapter 27. First book of Samuel chapter 27. My topic this morning is continuing on with a man after God's own heart. When smart people make foolish decisions. 1 Samuel chapter 27, and we'll commence reading at verse 1. And David said in his heart, I shall now perish one day by the hand of Saul. There is nothing better for me than I should speedily escape into the land of the Philistines, and Saul shall despair of me to seek me any more in the coast of Israel. So I shall escape out of his hand. And David rose, and he passed over with the 600 men that were with him unto Achish, a son of Maacah, king of Gath. And David dwelt with Achish at Gath, he and his men, every man with his household, even David with his two wives, Ahinomo of Jezreelis and Abigail, the Carmelites, Nabal's wife. And it was told Saul that David was fled to Gath, and he sought no more again for him. God will bless to us his precious word. I want you to place yourself this morning in David's sandals or David's shoes for just a moment. You were a teenager, and you were appointed as going to be the next king of Israel. Samuel, the old man of God, came and anointed you for this office. The next thing you know, you are in the royal palace playing your harp and singing for the king. Then, like a whirlwind, one activity after another took place in your life and brought you to national importance. You killed Goliath with a single stone thrown from a sling. You were promoted to an army and made captain of 1,000 men. You married the king's daughter, and you were best friends with the king's son. It seemed that every event in your life was bringing you even closer to that day when you would claim to be the king of Israel. Then things begin to happen. Cracks begin to appear in the perfectly constructed life that you enjoyed so much. You felt out of favor with the king, and he even tried to kill you. Your relationship with your wife had ended. You could not no longer fellowship with Jonathan, your best friend. You were demoted and lost your position in the army. The next thing you know, you are a fugitive and you're running for your own life, away from the insane king who has determined to take your life. Yet, even as you run from your enemy, you continue to carry yourself well. You spare the king's life when you're an opportunity to kill him. You could have taken his life. It was handed to you. You showed compassion when dealing with others you could have destroyed in a moment. You even continued to seek God's direction for your life, believing that someday his promise for your life would be fulfilled. Then one day, something changed. You woke up as usual, and something was different in the old world. For the first time, it looked like God had forsaken you. God had given up on you. It looks like the enemy will even prevail. You become discouraged, disillusioned, and find yourself trapped in a pit of hopelessness. while you were in that state of despair, you make a foolish decision that altered the course of your life. This brings you troubles that you could never have imagined, troubles that you really never thought you would ever be in. That is, in a nutshell, the life of David right up to this moment. David was on a fast track to the kingdom, and now he's a fugitive on the run. Our text finds David hunted and hounded. He is defeated, discouraged, and he's depressed. Have you ever been in all those places? And while he is in the condition, he makes a foolish decision that will produce some very serious consequences in his life. David decided to give up on God. He decided to give up on God's plan for his life. He decided that somehow God must have forsaken him. God must have forgotten about him. He decided that God's plan for his life had failed. David took his own life in his own hand and began to live for himself as he liked. Just as he pleased, he was going to live his life. As I think about this stage of David's life, I see in him a portrait of every believer, or of many believers I have met over the years. David pictures people who have been saved by the wonderful grace of God and began well, were on fire for God, and then suddenly they walked away from God. They walked away back into the world and back into the things of God. But somewhere along the way, things didn't go as they had envisioned, and they became discouraged, disillusioned, and totally defeated. In their weakness, spiritual condition, they made a terrible decision, and the terrible consequences followed their lives. Instead of staying close to the Lord as they should have, and following his life, and following the steps of God, and keeping your eyes fixed totally upon God, they choose to walk away from God and to live their lives in a carnal, compromised position. They've made a tragic decision, and they paid a high price for that decision. Today, I would like to take David's life and point out where we go wrong in our decision-making in life. What we can expect when we make those terrible decisions. I want you to make three observations as we look into these verses today and think about when smart people make foolish decisions. David is a picture here of having a conversation with himself. Instead of turning to God in prayer and seeking God, David turned to himself for counsel. The advice he received from himself is anything but wise. When David communed with his heart, he immediately forgot all the great promises that God had made to him a while back ago. God had promised David that he would be king. That promise had been confirmed by Jonathan, and it had been confirmed by Abigail and even Saul. And yet, all these great promises are forgotten about when David begins to listen to his own heart. They're gone. David even thinks that he knows what will happen out there in the future. He thinks he has got it all sorted out in his mind. He should have known that God, our God, is a sovereign God who has total control over all things, past, present, and future. And I believe that it's a good thing for us to keep that in mind, that God is in control of the past, of the future, and of the present, in total control. Because David listened to his heart, he chose to abandon the path of life that God had placed him in years beforehand. He decided that he would be better off fleeing to the land of the Philistines, the enemy of God. He thought that he would be safe away from King Saul. Imagine the future king of Israel running to the arch enemy of God to beg for help. How terrible. That's how far down this man had gone. That's the kind of trouble David's heart had got him into. Beware of trusting your own heart. When we consult our heart, we will get in touch with our own human nature. And our old human nature is fallen. It is always good to look at things in an earthly level. When people say, well, I feel it in my heart, you can be sure that they're heading for trouble. That is why that the Bible cautions us against trusting our hearts. Listen to the Jeremiah 17 and verse 9. The heart is deceitful, and above all things, and desperately wicked, who can know it? The heart is deceitful. When you talk to yourself, be sure to talk to yourself about the things of God. You see, your heart will say things like, this church is dead. These people don't like you. God is being unfair with you. You'd be far better staying at home. Don't bother coming out on a Sunday evening. Go elsewhere, etc. Many of you know exactly what I'm talking about this morning. Your heart will trick you, deceive you, lie to you, and lead you down the wrong paths of life. If you listen to your heart, you will find yourself where David found himself exactly. Out of God's will, out of God's place for his life, and out of God's fellowship. What an awful place to be. Away from God, away from the fellowship of God's people, in a total state of despair. And that's where David was. If you listen to your heart, you will find yourself living in a place of compromise. And you will find yourself in a backslidden state. David made wrong decisions because he listened to his heart and it led him astray. Be careful. Be very careful, or you could end up in the same way this morning. The people in David's life were also affected. You see, because of David's foolish decision that he made, everyone who was in touch with David was affected as well. That's the big problem, isn't it? When we go astray and when we go down wrong roads, we don't only affect ourselves, but we affect others as well. All 600 men and their families and their wives and their children. Everyone around David was brought down by David's foolish decision. All of these people were brought into a place of compromise and temptation because one man listened to his heart instead of listening to the Lord. You see, the day that we take our eyes and our thoughts off God, we're in trouble, deep trouble. Romans 14 and verse 7 says, for none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. That basically means that everything we do in our lives touches others around us. We affect other people. We affect our own family. When one or both parents refuse to live by God's standards, it's going to impact our children. Of course it is. When people at school, at work, at church are touched by the way that we live our lives, they look at us. We never know who is watching. That's why that the Bible talks about us living circumspectly. We're living as representatives of the Lord Jesus Christ when we go out into the world, when we go down the town, when we're at work, when we're dealing with people. We're representatives of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we should always remember that. It's important. Remember, there is a price to pay for touching others in a negative manner. Luke chapter 17 and verse 1. Then said he unto the disciples, It is impossible that offense will come, but woe unto him through whom it cometh. It is better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he is cast into the sea than that he should offend one of these little ones. Not only did David's decision affect the people around him in a very, very deep way, but it also altered David's life. In other words, his decision to walk away from the Lord changed him completely, totally. Look at some of the things that the Bible reveals about the tragic time of David's life. When a believer makes that fatal decision to walk away from the Lord and to do his own thing and away from the blessing of the Lord, their life will be affected in a negative way. That's for sure. Like the prodigal, their life will be false, living in a false sense of security. The one who walked away will find that they are soon doing the things that they would have never done, never been guilty of, and that they are doing them with a crowd that they would have never have run about with before. You see, when we come to that situation and come to a backslidden state, walk away from God, then anything can happen in our lives. We'll go down and down and down as low as we can ever be. And that's where David was. They will find that their entire lifestyle can be changed. And they will look around and find that months and years have passed while they languish in the far country. They will also find that their song has disappeared. Their joy has dried up. You cannot walk away from God and go off into the sin and not be affected. You have to be affected. If walking away from the Lord does not alter your life, then I venture to say that there's something seriously wrong with your conversion in the first place. The chorus says, sin will take you further than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you ever want to pay. We are seeing the truth of David's life. In this passage, David has fallen about as far as a man could fall. He's out of God's will. He's out of God's path. And actively working with the enemy against the Lord. How about that? He's as far down as he can get. But thankfully, David is not having a good time. You see, his sin affected the people in his life. It affected the pattern of his life, but it also affected the peace in his life. He had no peace. David loses far more than he could ever have imagined. David finally reached the bottom. The men turned on him and threatened to kill him. You and I may walk away from the Lord. We may go our own separate ways, but we will not do so without paying a terrible high price for it. What will it cost you? Thank God the story doesn't end there. I'm glad to say that we get to witness David's recovery from his sin as well. David repented before God. When David finally hits the bottom, then he has lost all his men, lost everything. At long last, David looks towards heaven again. Perhaps he realizes that he's looking at the bottom of his lives, his life that is shattered, and the other lives that are shattered around him. That's everything that has happened was a result of his foolish decisions that he made, listening to his own heart, followed by the foolish decision on his part. David turned his gaze heavenwards once again in humble repentance. Now David does what he should have done at the beginning of the episode of his life. David called on the Lord in prayer and he seeks God's will and God's help. David is back in a place where he can rely on the Lord totally and utterly once again. When David hears the Lord's direction of his life, he's no hesitation but to follow the Lord. But he goes out immediately to do the Lord's will. He is now walking with the Lord. He's no longer listening to David. He is back in God's will, walking with God. David has been fully and totally restored. What a merciful God we have this morning to know that even though David turned his back upon God and walked away from God, and yet here is a merciful God taking him back again and restoring him back to where he was. The first step in getting things right, we need to get before the Lord and deal honestly and truthfully with our sin. David has been out of God's will for 16 months. Then he falls down before the Lord and the Lord deals with his sin. Then when David calls out from a right spirit, the Lord instantly forgives, restores, and communicates with David once again. God's answer is swift and sure and accurate. Regardless of how smart we are, or we might think we are, regardless of how long we may have been saved, or regardless of how high we have climbed up the spiritual ladder, we are all capable of falling. We're all capable of going down the wrong road. The most foolish mistake you will ever make is walking away from God. Listen to his voice, not your heart, and do as he says. I leave you with trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise thee, Lord, today for this lovely service. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we've been allowed to meet with you and around your lovely table to listen to your precious word. Father, we're a privileged people today, and we give you thanks for it. Oh God, we ask you, Lord, that your word will go deep into our hearts and into our lives, and that, oh Father, we will go away from this place knowing that we have met with God. Father, we pray for the evening service. Lord, we pray indeed that we will make that special effort of coming out to the house of God tonight, Lord, and Father, to hear the word of God again. We pray, Father, that you will bless your word to our hearts tonight, and grant that, O God, that we'll have another time of great blessing in the house of the Lord, and that some soul or souls will come to know Christ as their Savior and Lord and Master. We ask it for Christ's sake. Amen. We're going to sing a closing hymn together. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Let's stand as we sing together. richly bless you.